Thank you. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Can we amen Carolyn Sauer's beautiful organ music? Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, Carolyn. We're going to hear some more of that great music in just a few moments. Thank you for closing the doors, deacons and deaconesses. You are at 385 East Dublin Granville Road, and we are on television, but you only the back of your heads can be seen, so don't worry unless you have a halo started like I have back here. Carolyn and I are the only ones that can be seen from our friends. Hi, everybody. Now, you have a bulletin, and in the second service, in order for people to really, really get the full nuances of what we're trying to say, we try to emphasize some of the more notable things. And one of them is tonight at 6 o'clock right here, Jamie George, or Jaime Jorge, whatever, you can say it Spanish or English, is going to be here, and it's going to be worth your time. And we're going to hear some of the a visitor that's going to be with him in a little bit. Brother Tim Noble will be helping us. I'm glad to see him and his family here. Amen. All the way from, is it Mount Vernon? That's a long drive, isn't it, you guys? It can be a long drive. It can be, I tell you. Well, we're happy that you're here, and when you're here at this church, you're welcome, and you can always fill out a transfer membership to our church because we love people here. Just don't tell them don't tell the shoemakers I said that. No, they could probably see it on TV if they're. Okay, got your bulletin here. Let's take a run at this. Number one, this program here. This is the flyer. There's still time to tell your neighbors. This is a great thing to tell your neighbors to come through. They're going to love this. So 6 o'clock tonight. Bring your friends. This is, you don't have to dress up. You can just come and sit down and enjoy. It's a good Vesper program. It's a good chance to meet wonderful new friends and hear awesome music. Okay? Now, this is the lifeblood of our church because it's you. Okay? So, I know that each of you have your own idea of what you want out of church. I will tell you that my idea is no one has to greet me. I go to church to greet people. So if no one says anything to me, that's my problem. But to other people, they don't have my personality. They need someone sometimes to, or some people just need to teach a class, or they need to come and shake a hand, or they need to come and they need to sing a song or be involved in all these different ministries. Kathleen Bumgartner, which is on one of our personal committee, the nominating committee, crafted this wonderful letter. She's sitting out there today. We thank you for you to take and look at this and help out. You can take all kinds of check marks and make this work, and then Yuliyan and I will be really happy to see that happen. Okay, this card that Yuliyan brings towards the end of it of the service, you can start now by writing the things about your name and address. In the front office, we need birthdays corrected. Sometimes we have it incorrect or we don't have them. Your email's up to date. Some of you change your emails all the time. You change your phone numbers all the time. Some of you even change your addresses all the time. So make sure that we have that so that we can be prompt in this. Now, probably some news that I don't like to give, but it's part of the news of our church, is that David Wagner, the son of Dee and Bill Wagner, called me. It was last evening. That was this morning, but I talked to so many people. Last evening, he said, my father is moved to the Kobacker house. And if you want to go see him, even though he may not know who you are, you know who you are, and you know what you need to do. Maybe a visit to the Kobacker house would be appropriate for you as soon as possible to see our brother Bill. I can't explain, I'm not a medical doctor, but I can tell you one thing. His issues are, unless God does something, yes sir. The Kobacker house, I don't have the I know how to go there, but the exact address would be, someone with a, help me out here. Yes sir, Robert. North of Riverside, half a mile. North Riverside, half a mile. Now, I've been there many times, but just to give you the exact, right, I don't have that. So if you, but thank you, gentlemen, for that. You need to go. I don't care if it's a lineup, you need to go. So go over there and see this brother and his family, as I know that the Wagners have been outstanding people in our community and our church, outstanding. And so they've been good to me and my family and many of you as well. If you take a look at the people's names, Roger Curley still he needs some prayer for a speedy recovery. Tom Esman has his radiation treatment. And Debbie Crum, her legs are healing from her accident. And there are others that we don't mention, but we know that they're in need of prayer and they're in need of visiting, emailing, or calling. Now, folks, Brother Vance, Bev Vance, he and his wife have a ministry right out in the front recovering medical pills and such, prescriptions. Please note that we are retrieving these. Bring them. It's a great ministry to take right over in the back. Go out to your car before you go if you have something you don't want and bring them in. And it reminds me that they do a 55-plus potluck next week. I can go to this now. I'm so thrilled. I'm so glad that I'm old enough to go to this potluck. Some of you aren't old enough yet. But if you're married to somebody, you get to grandfather that's going to be a good thing. Yuliyan can only go because he's my son. No, he can only go. But otherwise, we wouldn't let him go either, okay, because he's too young. Okay. Now, we are the ASL, which is American Sign Language, from our dear sister and elder Sarah Wilson, and she does a phenomenal job. My sons love it. My wife, they're very good. And now Johnny Chu and his wife and others, right over here in the Garden Buller place, right over here. We're going to do this. So after the second service, sign language. Wouldn't that be fun? This means I love you. If we can all do this, that's all you really need to know. I love you. Okay. That's what you can do. That's a cool thing to do. You don't want to do the, you know, hang loose, or you don't want to do the Texas Longhorns or these Thorwards here. We don't do that. But anyway, we have men's Bible study, combined Bible study, women's Bible study. We got tons of Bible studies. Amen. I mean, seriously, Adventists are known for their Bible study. Let's keep that going, and let's keep it opportunities. You can't say you don't have an opportunity, because you do here at this church. We need deacons. We need deaconesses. Little Lamb starts October 31, right up in that building up there, the Crater Roll. We need moms or ladies that love kids, even men who love kids, who want to come up and spend some time to help. Amen, amen. Now, Worthington Academy is in need of some things that you can read, and if the Lord gets this on your heart, well, hey, you can do that. And finally, folks, can you believe that we're in October already, in 2015? Can you believe that? It's crazy. The life is going by so fast, okay? And I asked my son, do you want life to go by fast or slow? He says, as I get older, I want it to slow down. And he's only 11. Little kids want life to go by fast. Older people want it to go by slower, right? So there's lots of things. Now, I don't see Yuliyan, you need to help me with this one. Did the announcement for the engagement, do they want to make that here as well? Okay, maybe, yeah, if they want to. I'll let them do that, so I don't want to step on anybody. There are all kinds of things that Yuliyan and I would like to be able to do for you, like if your house needs to be dedicated, your kids need to be dedicated, something. Please, folks, let us know. We'd like to drive over there, hang out with you, and I'll bring some donuts with no sugar in them, and we can enjoy that together. But Carolyn, today's a beautiful day. Bob Bradley is not here with us. That's the only sad part that I can say. Bob Bradley is not here. So maybe you could email him and call him and say how disappointed you were that he wasn't there. Could some of you do that for me? Just tease. You know how fun Bob Bradley is. He's just a great guy. So we'll do that. But it's time to sing our song, and it's time to love people, and it's time to recognize our visitors and all the people here, so that they'll say, Worthington Adventist Church. What a great church that was. Oh, I'm so glad I'm a part. Ready? Stand up, members. Let's do your thing. Here we go. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I am one.
washed in the fountain.
Stay standing and sing our opening hymn, 523. Stay standing.
Sabbath, you may be seated.
At this time, it says a prayer, and we're going to have every once, maybe 4 or 5, 6 weeks, a garden of prayer. We found that it's a very valuable tool. People like me think of the story of the Pool of Bethesda. You ever heard of that pool before? And you know, the whole idea of this pool was what? It was to get into the pool when the Holy Spirit stirred the waters. I mean, if we're Christians, we got to believe that. I mean, that's what we believe, right? Right? So, I don't know how God works in some ways that that if we follow this, it would be much easier for us to live. The idea was for those that were physically able to help the person into the pool because they couldn't get in there. This is what a church does, the body of Christ. They help the person go get the blessing. Come on, amen to that. So you go and you help somebody go get a blessing because they want the blessing. They can almost taste the blessing, but you got to serve the food so they can taste it. They want to get into the water, and there was a person that waited. They just waited and waited, and they couldn't get in. How terrible that is. I liken it to they needed a visit. They needed a visit. They needed a visit. People just were too busy to visit. They needed a call. They needed a call, but it was just too hard to dial. They needed an email. It was just too hard to turn on the computer and write it. I'm not trying to make anybody feel guilty because, you know, as many people as I call, I still miss all the time. Pastor Bob, I thought we were better friends than this. You forgot me. And they know that hurts me because they know that I don't want to forget, but I did. And so this is why when the water is stirring now, we have an opportunity now to help that person to the water. You know how happy they are when they get in that water? They're healed. That's how happy they are. What a great story. What a great story. When they get into the water, then the love of God permeates, the message of God permeates right through. I'm going to ask our elders not to do anything but to stand where you're at. I want you, elders of this church, to stand. Sheila, you're an elder at this church. You can stand too, okay? To stand. If you're an elder in this church, you can stand. There's nothing wrong with it to stand. You're an elder in this church, stand. Now stay standing. Because I'm going to ask for us to watch what happens when each one of us is the blessing giver by being able to reach out to someone. If you, each elder, would find one or two people, find two people and put your hand on their shoulder, I'd appreciate it. Just find two people and put your hand on their shoulder, an elder. Yeah, okay, we're going to have a prayer. You, Pastor Yuliyan and I are going to pray. We want you to find, okay, now, I would like someone else. I know that the elders, they're called to do this, so I'm not going to embarrass anyone, okay? These elders already know. You already know when you're an elder this is what happens, don't you? Okay, so there are people around. And I want you to pretend today, because it's not hard to pretend in something that I believe is true, and that's that you have angels with you too. And so if you feel comfortable, if you don't, then don't do it. But if you feel comfortable, if you could put your hand on someone else's shoulder, if not, don't worry about it. It doesn't mean you're bad or you're not a Christian. And I'm going to ask Yuliyan to have a prayer for this blessing that happens only when the water stirs. Okay? So this is what we're doing today at the Worthington Seventh-day Adventist Church. Okay, here we go. This is the blessing.
Father in heaven, as our elders are laying their hands on the people around them, I would like to ask you, with your divine power and presence, to lay your hands and your blessings upon each one of us here and also on those who are watching us online right now. Would you please, Lord, assist us and minister to our needs according to what we need right now. But above all, would you please stir our hearts to see that we are instruments to supply other people's needs. In the name of Jesus, we ask you for your presence here. In the name of Jesus, we ask you also to fill up our hearts with blessings so that we can overflow and give to others too. And let everybody here say together, Amen.
Thank you, elders, as well. Thank you. I know that there's a lot of touch in the world that's not good. But you know why? Because there's a lot of touch that's good that doesn't get given. So let's replace the bad touch with the good touch today. And we had a spot of that. Folks, I said Bob Bradley is not here, and when he's not here, it's just not the same. He makes me laugh, he makes me think, and he encourages me to be the type of person that would want to really try harder in life, and I appreciate him. And so I talked to him, and I talked with Pastor Yuliyan, and guess what? Today's offering is going to be something that as we receive the offering that we're giving because we are truly grateful. Yes, we have needs. And I'd ask for the deacons, the junior deacons, to come up. All four of these people are under the age of 21 years old. Do you believe that statement as they come up here? All four of these are under the age of 21. Do you believe that statement? Dan, this is the youngest one over here. This one over here. What a beautiful group. Thanksgiving's coming. We have our Heritage Sabbath coming up. We have all kinds of programs that we're thankful for. We have beautiful music here. Carolyn always makes sure. We have a gentleman, Tim Noble, is going to play today. He's an awesome keyboardist. And guess what? He's going to be here later on, too. So we're really excited about that, too. You brought your family. And what I noticed is it's nice to be, you have groupies. It's good. And we're all Jesus groupies in this church today. And so as we're Jesus groupies, we're going to give our thanks in a form of our tithes and offerings today, but we also give our hearts to God. And we don't have to worry what man may say or man may do, because truly Jesus is all right with us. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the Worthington Seventh Adventist Church. And as I held up the blue sign earlier about impacting others for eternity, and I looked and I saw deacons, greeters, committees, deaf ministries, all the different ministries, health and landscape. And I looked at these and I said, not one person can do those things. In fact, one family can't even do it. And if you're the richest person in the world, you can't not buy love. You have to have everybody doing what they can do. Some people are blessed with financial means, but they still need other people, just like the Pool of Bethesda. It wasn't about anything that could buy that blessing. You had to get in there and had to be assisted by others. And so I hope that the all-time assist leader will be people from this church. We're thankful for the visitors that are here today, and we're thankful for the lists of people that that sign up to do things, take care of the children. But most of all, we reach out to you for those people who are suffering in severe pain. I can be friendly and cheerful and hug people and say what a great day it is and how wonderful a blessing this is, but there are still people who have been diagnosed with things that cannot be, on this earth, taken care of. There are still financial things that some people won't be able to, they can't get back. And I know that, and I've experienced some of these things, and every time I see something on my skin or I see ache and pain, I wonder if it's cancer or if I have a tumor or if I've got this. And we become paranoid, and I don't want that to happen to anybody as it happens to me. And then I wonder, well, how long is this going to happen in church, or this going to happen in the world, in the city, the government? We got to get the right president and the right this and that. And I worry so much that I'm no earthly good to anyone else. So today, as I can do what I can do, as the folks can do what they can do, may we enjoy what's happening now. Thank you for this church. Thank you for the opportunity to give. The music that's going to be played, the message is going to be given, and as I was privileged to hear Yuliyan's Make Your Race Count, I hope that each one of us will realize that just being in the race is a blessing, is an honor to be in that race, and we will finish because our author and finisher has told us it is so. Amen.
your glasses. Oh, those are not yours, okay?
I try to use them. Somebody has worse eyesight than I do.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, church. My name is Pastor Yuliyan. I have the privilege to have the title of a lead pastor of this church, and I will never get tired of repeating that. Woe to us if I'm the lead pastor, not Jesus. So I'm happy together with Pastor Bob to be under shepherds, under the great shepherd of our souls. Timothy, brother, wow. God has poured some talent on you, and you have not been lazy in his practice also. So, wow. So thank you very much. And I guess I don't need to tell you what your name means. Timotheos means honor to God, giving honor to God. So what you did today, employing your talents, you gave honor to God, and we appreciate that. And all these applauses, all this clapping was not for you, brother. Don't confuse that. People like you, but not that much. It was about your talent. It was what God has given you, and of course, what you have put also in practice. So thank you so much for bringing that. Friends, before I begin with our message today, I would like to make a few announcements. I was wondering if it will be too much for Miriam to come down here. I just want to show her face here, not for you to have to turn back. You know that we have looked for, some of you know, not all of you, some of you know that we have looked for a secretary because our faithful secretary, Sarah Wilson, has to move on and has to continue her education, and it's a little bit too much right now. And we appreciate what she has done faithfully, and officially we're going to do something the second Sabbath of next month. But right now, because some of you are going to call the office and you're going to be wondering why is not Sarah picking up the phone and someone else, I would like to introduce the someone else. So, Miriam Thompson, would you please join me here? Friends, this is our new church secretary, your new church secretary, Miriam. And Miriam and her husband, Kevin, they have three children. And Kevin is three children. He's a chaplain, and now, right now he's on duty, but he's going to join us next Sabbath. And second Sabbath of the month, you're going to be here, we're going to celebrate and appreciate also Sarah and introduce more in detail Miriam. In the meantime, would you like to tell them exactly from where you're coming from?
From St. Lucia in the Caribbean, and I have lived in New York City, Loma Linda, California, Ohio when my first son was born. Then I moved to Michigan. I supported U of M, don't hate me, and and now we're back in Ohio, and we are glad to be here. We are glad to meet all of you, and I look forward to serve you and for you to serve me as well. Thank you,
Miriam. Okay, well, thank you very much, Miriam, and looking forward for our congregation to get to know you better. Two more announcements. The second one is first service. We had the privilege to introduce a couple to be. They got engaged. Many of you know the family of the Schuens. Some of them are here. First service were Kasha and Jonathan, who just announced that they are engaged, which is amazing news. So now it's public, so you can call them and let them know that you know. The second thing that I would like you to pray for is my mother. Told that she fell her hip. She's 78 years old, and she has to have surgery Monday, which for us here in America is going to be Sunday evening, Sunday afternoon. So please lift her up in prayer. And I'm saying that not just because she's my mother-in-law. She's the most godly person the godliest person I've ever met in my life. I mean, I've learned a lot about God from her. I've learned a lot of how to handle situation and life. So please lift her up in prayer. I'll really appreciate that. That said, let's bow our heads for prayer. Father, would you please bless your word and let me step in the back and let me stay in the shadows of your glory. And would you please shine, minister to our needs, and let your name be proclaimed loud and clear today. In the name of your son Jesus, amen. I would like to begin this message, by the way, for those who are new here, this is continuation of our study of the book of Acts. And I would like to begin our message with one of the three philosophical existential questions, actually the second of the three. And try to answer for yourself, try to figure out your answer to this question. What is the purpose of your life? Is it to marry a beautiful wife, to marry a handsome guy? Is it to make a lot of money? Is it to become famous? Is it to impress people with your appearance? What is your goal in life? Many people will say, I'm happy to be happy. If I have that, it's enough. Today, I will let Apostle Paul tell us what makes life worthwhile for him. What makes life worth living, according to Paul? Today, in the flow of our study of the book of Acts, and we are going verse by verse, today we are going to study Paul's farewell address. This is the last speech he'll make to the people of the church of Ephesus, which, by the way, in the Greco-Roman world, was one of the largest churches of the first century. And this is the first church which Jesus addresses in the book of Revelation, the church of Ephesus. So he gave his farewell address. And it's amazing to hear it, and you're going to hear it in a minute. But in the meantime, if you were to give your farewell address today to your friends, to your family, to your enemies, what are you going to tell them? What is your legacy going to be that will make a difference for the generation to come? Or you're just this short stroke between two dates on a gravestone, are you? What is your farewell speech to the ones you love? And I've titled my message today, Make Your Race Count. So would you please open with me your Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 20, Acts 20. The farewell address of Apostle Paul is found in Acts chapter 20, verses 17 through 35. So the farewell address of Paul is found in Acts 20, verses 17 through 35. And before we start reading it, I would like to tell you that the farewell address of Paul is three-dimensional. It's very well structured, it's very well thought. It's not just random words. The farewell address of Paul begins with a look that he cast in the past. He shows the church or the church elders of Ephesus what happened in the past in his life. What is his philosophy of life? Then he moves to the present and finally to the future. And it's interesting that his speech about the past, verses 18 through 21, is only one sentence in Greek. And the Bible was written, the New Testament was written in Greek. It's only one sentence. In one sentence, Apostle Paul gives a summary of what a worthwhile life looks like. Then he moves to the description of the present time. And then he takes three sentences, expands more. And finally, he goes to the future, and he takes the most of the time, speaking about the future, leaving a legacy to the new generation to continue the future of the church. Friends, our church Not just Seventh-day Adventist Church, any church in the world is only one generation away from extinction. What are you going to leave to your children and grandchildren? So let's listen to Apostle Paul. And for those of you who are new here, the congregation reads the verses, and we have a helpful young deacon, Olivia, is going to help you with a microphone. Lift up your hand if you would like to read the Word of God, and Olivia is going to come to you. Thank you very much, Marge. Let's hear the Word of God, Acts 20, verses 17 through 21.
From Miletus, he sent a message to Ephesus, asking the elders of the church to meet him. When they came to him, he said to them, "You yourselves know how I lived among you the entire time from the first day that I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears, enduring the trials that came to me through the plots of the Jews. I did not shrink from doing anything helpful, proclaiming the message to you and teaching you publicly and from house to house, as I testified to both Jews and Greeks about repentance towards God and faith toward our Lord Jesus."
Thank you, Marge. Thank you. Apostle Paul is finishing his third last journey, missionary journey. He is on the way to Jerusalem. And he actually will later tell them, "This is the last time I see you," verse 25. And while the ship is making its way down the Aegean Sea toward the Mediterranean Sea, in God's providence, the ship stops in Miletus. This is a city that is only 30 miles away from Ephesus. And the layover was long enough for Paul to send a messenger and to bring the elders of the church. This is an elders meeting. He's summoning an elders meeting. And here they come. And he gives to the elders, to the leaders of the church, his heart. He gives everything that he's trying to do for salvation of people. And listen to what we discover. Verse 18 begins, "You know in what manner of what tense is that? Past. So here he starts describing the past. And in describing the past, Apostle Paul describes his philosophy of life and ministry. First he says, by the way, there are 10 or 11 elements described in these three verses, but they are governed by three elements that are actually the philosophy of Paul's life. First, he says, "I served in all humility." Many people today have a very skewed perception of what humility is all about. First, let me tell you what the English word humility means. The word humility originates from the Latin word that is the root of the word humus, the top of the soil, dirt. And it's related to, it comes originally from a Hebrew word that means to bow down to the ground, to worship to the ground. True humility is the realization that without God, you are dirt. Without God, as your creator, you're nobody. True humility is complete submission of all your plans, of all your life to God. Worshipping Him with your life, not just in church. True humility is the realization that you are God's by creation and also by salvation. That even the dirt you are taken from was watered on Calvary with the blood of our Savior. Apostle Paul says, "I live my life with this deep realization that without God I'm nobody, but with God I'm worth everything. Heaven paid the most expensive price for me. Therefore I'm God's. I belong to Him by creation and salvation." Then he says, "I served with courage." And this is found in the next verse, in verse 20. "I did not shrink from telling what is profitable for all of you." Literally in Greek, it implies the idea, I was not a coward. I proclaimed the Word of God, even then when the Word of God was inconvenient, even then when the Word of God meant for me prison, scourging, and rejection of both Jews and Gentiles. And friends, you cannot imagine what a value courage, true courage, biblical courage is. It is so important that in the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verse 8, when several characteristics are listed of people who are never going to make it to heaven, the very first characteristic is cowards are not going to make it to heaven. People who do not have this spiritual courage that it takes to be a Christian, that it takes to submit yourself and humble yourself under the authority of God. And yet, the courage to do what God asks you to do, even when people don't like you. Even what you are telling people is offensive to them, but you are doing what God asks you to do. And finally, the last characteristic of the past that describes the philosophy of Paul's life is testimony. In Greek, the word is martyro or martyromai. This word appears four times in the speech of Apostle Paul. Four times. And I've learned something about the Bible. When the Bible repeats a word many times, God is telling us, pay attention, this is important, right? And I would like to tell you that of all these three characteristics, the testimony is the key, the leitmotif of the whole passage. And we're going to talk a little bit more about it, but right now I'd like to tell you, testimony is integrity on display. Testimony is to be authentic and to be godly authentic. Many of us are authentic, but we are offensively authentic and we are jerkish authentic. We are not testifying of God and we are not bringing glory to God. So, the third element, testimony. This was the secret of Paul's method of evangelism. This was his secret of how he permeated this almost iron wall of paganism of the Roman Empire. It was not his methods that permeated Western world. It was his testimony. And the testimony of Paul was, he was a walking sermon. Paul was a walking sermon. What he preached was illustrated in his life, every single bit of it. And friends, many times, especially us pastors, when we hear some big celebrity pastor who has built a big church, we want to go and pay big bucks to listen to his presentation, to give us some secrets. How can we make a big church and fill the pews with people? I guess if Paul were to preach, here's my secret how I fill the church and how I made new congregations all over the Roman Empire, he will say, my secret was a testimony. I was a walking sermon. Everything I believed, I exemplified. I was on fire for God. I love him dearly from the bottom of my heart. And every single time you have this attitude, friends, it's going to spill over. There are going to be people affected by your testimony left and right. No amount of doctrinal preaching is going to do what a good walking sermon can do. And now I would like to give you an example. I can give you actually hundreds of examples, but I would like to give you an example of recent time of the power of testimony. I don't know how many of you have heard of Thomas Malcolm Magridge. He was a journalist, radio and TV celebrity in Great Britain. He actually was during the 1930s in Russia, in Moscow. He was enchanted with the communism and he wanted to embrace the idea of communism because communism started appealing to him. Equality between people, no oppression of people. Everybody has the same. And when he saw, during the year and a half he was a correspondent in Russia, in Moscow, when he saw communism in action, he quickly abandoned this idea of communism, and he was still searching for other things that make sense in life. He was looking for the meaning of life. But he was an atheist as atheists go. He He didn't believe in any God. He had some friends who were godly people. He never accepted their messages. No matter how much they tried to preach to him, gave him books to read, nothing worked. At the age of 65, suddenly, seemingly out of the blue, Malcolm Muggeridge became a Christian. And Great Britain was shocked. They couldn't understand what happened. So, of course, they asked him. He was a TV show guy, and they invited him on different shows, and they asked him. So here is the reason why this famous atheist became a Christian. He said, "I could resist and explain away all the great Christian books." He read plenty of Christian books. His friends gave him many books. And he said, "And I can explain away all the great sermons and ignore them. But," he said, "when I saw Mother Teresa in Calcutta with the poor, I said to myself, if this is it, I've got to have it." During the 1960s, he was sent as a correspondent of one of the magazines, I forgot which one was it, and he was there together with his film crew filming the life of Mother Teresa, because she was becoming famous at that time, and he was following her, observing her life, taking care of the leper, taking care of these sick people, taking care of people who are laying down the street in the dirt. And at first he thought, well, this is just a charade and all that. But the longer he observed her life, he said, this is for real. And when he saw with how much joy and purpose she was doing these menial jobs of cleaning dirty beggars, he was blown away. And he said, this is what I have been looking for my entire life. I was looking for a belief that will change my life and give purpose. And he said, the testimony, the walking sermon of this lady made me a Christian. Now I know some of you will say, oh, pastor, but don't you know that she was a Catholic? Of course I know. And do you know that there are some good Catholics? I hope you do. Listen. God used a good Catholic to change the heart of this person, because they were not an Adventist doing what she was doing in Calcutta. Do you hear that? Friends, God may need you somewhere, but you're not there. What God needs you somewhere in Columbus, where nobody will go, where nobody will do the menial service. And what if God has called you to do that? And it's not honorable, and it's not gloriousome. Nobody's going to clap for you because you're not standing on a podium or a pulpit. You're not preaching. You're not playing an instrument. You're just doing a very dirty menial job. What about that? Huh? Listen. Whatever God has called you to do, He has also called an audience to watch you. Someone is going to believe in God because of your testimony if you stay where God has sent you and placed you in life to be. When God puts you in a particular place, He never puts you just as a doer of a particular job. He puts also an audience there for you. Later, I would like to give you a quotation from Malcolm. He actually wrote several Christian books. And this is one of his famous quotations, and I love this one because it lines so well with one of the quotations that you can find in the book Steps to Christ. I think it's page 87. So here is what he says. "Every happening, great and small, is a parable whereby God speaks to us. And the art of life is to get the message." He realized, he wrote this quotation because he realized, even during the time when he was an atheist, God was working in his life and he was speaking to him. At one point when he was during the Second World War, he was an MI6 agent in Northern Africa. And he was so discouraged with life, he tried to commit a suicide. But he was not able to. The weapon didn't cooperate. He mentions other stories when God was doing miracles in his life. But back when he was an atheist, he didn't notice them. He ignored them. When he became a Christian, he started noticing that God is talking to us through the providence, through the circumstances of life. And it's exactly what in this particular chapter Ellen White says. God speaks to us through his word, through his providence, and also through the working on our hearts. Are you used to listen and hear these messages? Or you just ignore them? Now let's move on, and I would like to conclude this part of Paul's message with this quotation from Apostle Peter. He says, "Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable. Walk a sermon that is worth listening to. Walk a sermon and live a testimony that is worth paying attention to. So that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your honorable behavior." And do what? And do what? "And glorify God on the day of visitation." Friends, many people are going to listen and hear God speaking to them if they see that he has spoken to you too and you've obeyed. Are you a walking testimony? Now, let's continue with the present time. Here is the second part of Apostle Paul's farewell message, and we're going to study only the first and the second. I'm going to leave the future for another time. Now, would you please lift up your hand and let's hear the word of God. So, chapter 20, verses 22 through 27. I'm sorry, next time. Thank you, Bill. Go ahead.
"And see, now I go bound in the Spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing the things that will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies in every city, saying that chains and tribulations await me. But none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy, and the ministry which I have received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. And indeed, now I know that you all, among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God, will see my face no more. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all men, for I have not shunned to declare to you the whole counsel of God."
Thank you, Bill. Thank you. Now, wake up and buckle up, because we are going to leave the comfort zone. I'm going to tell you a few things that are going to rattle your little American dream world. Paul says in verse 22, "I have to go to Jerusalem. I'm bound in the Spirit." Have you ever been bound in the Spirit? Nope. Do you remember that God speaks to us through his word, through his providence, and through the urging on the heart? To say it in another way, God plants an idea in your mind and heart and does not give you peace. You cannot sleep peacefully. You cannot do anything but thinking of that. You feel prompted to go in this direction, and then God, through his providence, starts opening the doors in this direction, and he's telling you, you have to go in this direction. So I would like to tell you a little bit about the Greek text, what the Greek text says here about Paul being bound in the Spirit. The Greek word for bound in the Spirit is dedamenos, and every scholar who knows biblical Greek or biblical Hebrew, who is worth his or her salt, will tell you that this is a perfect passive, and the perfect passive in the biblical syntax is called also divine passive. When you encounter this particular grammatical expression, particular lexical, syntactical order in the Bible, you know God, this is a way the ancient expressed the divine will of God. This is something that God wants you to do. This is something that is ordained according to his will. And what was the will of God? God wanted Paul to go to Jerusalem, where he is going to suffer, he's going to be chained, and he's going to go to prison. Wow. This is not the God I believe in. Thank you, Jesus. I'll see you another time. And when another sermon is preached, I don't like this preacher. Apostle Paul has learned something that we Westerners have such a hard time to learn. Life is not about our happiness, friends. According to God's perspective, life is not about our happiness. Yes, He wants us to be happy. Yes, He gives us a lot of blessings so that we are happy. But there are times when He asks us to do inconvenient things. When He asks us to go to places and do things that are going to cause us suffering. Are you willing to do it? Paul was sensitive first to hear this nudging, this knocking of the Spirit on his heart. He was sensitive enough to hear the knock. Most of us absolutely ignore it. And the longer you ignore it, the less audible the voice of the Holy Spirit becomes. So Paul first was sensitive to hear this knocking. The Greek expression tells us that he did not receive this by divine revelation, like a vision. Other prophets in every city he went, they told him from their visions that he's going to be chained and sent in prison. But he did not receive a revelation about that. He received only this soft knocking on his heart. And God was telling him, Paul, I want you to suffer for me. Would you? Paul was sensitive to hear and brave enough. Do you remember? The first characteristic of those who are going to enter heaven is courage. The first characteristic of those who are going to be excluded from there is cowardness. Paul was sensitive and brave enough to follow the directions God was leading him into. Paul was going against the American dream, friends, to say it in another way, in order for the dream of God to come true. And let me speak to you plainly in a language that you probably will understand. Sometimes God will allow. He's not the one who causes us suffering. He's not the one who causes us diseases. But sometimes God will allow some of us to end up in a hospital. Some of us to end up in a places where we'll never choose for ourselves. Because where you're going to end up, there are people who need to see a walking sermon. Who are never going to believe by giving them books or tracts or sending them some DVDs from Doug Batchelor. Are you willing to go there? And then, we don't have a lot of time, I would like to emphasize just one more element of Paul's sermon about the present time. He says, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me. The task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. Apostle Paul is telling us something that we have to really grasp here. And I'm going to rephrase it in another way. In other words, Apostle Paul is telling us, no matter the cost, no matter the amount of tears or discomfort or sacrifice, life, living according to the will of God, is well worth it. He's telling us life is not just existing. Life is not just keep on maintaining your physical functions. It is about fulfilling God's purpose for your life. Life, in another way, Paul is saying, is a testimony. Testimony of God's grace. And we are commanded, we are expected to preach it. Life is a legacy that you and I are expected to give to our children, to our grandchildren, and even to our friends and foes. In another way, Apostle Paul is telling us that if we live a life that does not fulfill God's purpose to glorify Him and to proclaim His grace and mercy and salvation, we have went astray. We've gone astray. We're not doing what God expects us to do. And some of you may ask yourself, okay, how can I become a walking sermon? How can I become a living testimony? It's very easy, and it's very difficult at the same time. You can allow the Word of God to change your life. Or you can come with thousands of excuses and try to find loopholes why you should not obey what God says to you. Listen to His voice. Sometimes He's going to ask you to do pleasant things and it will be glorious to do it. At other times, He's going to ask you to do unpleasant things. But it's still well worth doing what He expects you to do. Because if we ignore the Word of God, we cannot be changed. If you ignore the Word of God, you cannot be changed. And you'll be the same jerk you came to God 20 years ago, 30 or 40. As a matter of fact, it gets even worse, according to the spiritual law of entropy. Spiritual entropy. We actually get worse with time. If you're a jerk at the age of 20, at the age of 40, you're going to be a huge jerk, and at the age of 60, you'll be unbearable. So please allow God to change you with His Word. And Apostle Paul says why he's doing all these things. Why is he putting up with the suffering and the inconvenient parts of being a disciple of Jesus? He says, so that I may finish the race. So that I may finish the race. It was 7 p.m. on October 20th, 1968. A few thousand spectators were about to leave the Olympic Stadium in Mexico City. They have just watched the marathon race. And the winner has crossed the finish line almost an hour ago. And his name was Memo Walde from Ethiopia. And he finished the 26.2 miles as fresh as he started. Yet, in the meantime, an hour later, the last competitors were trickling in the Olympic Stadium. And when the crowd was about to leave, they've heard the sirens of the police and the whistles. And all they turned their eyes toward the gate, the entrance gate of the stadium, and they saw the wobbling figure of the last athlete in this marathon race. And he was wearing the outfit of the country of Tanzania. He was badly injured because of a fall. He had bandages of two places on his right leg, and he was bleeding. His run looked more like a wobbling walk, and every single step caused him tremendous pain. Yet he kept on walking his last 400 meters to the finish line. And when the crowd saw him, they got up on their feet and started chanting and started clapping and encouraging him to go and to do every one of these 450 steps he had to do to the finish line. Finally, when he crossed the finish line, the crowd was elated. Photographers and journalists were snapping pictures of him. But he never lifted up his head to look even at the crowd that was cheering for him. He went directly in the direction of the locker rooms. One of the journalists managed to get in front of him and ask him, "You didn't have any chance of winning a medal. Why don't you just quit?" Then the Tanzanian athlete by the name of John Stephen Akuwari lifted up his head, looked into the eyes of this journalist, and he said, "My country didn't send me 7,000 plus miles away to start a race. They sent me to finish a race." And friends, today I would like to tell you, God didn't call you into this churchy and Christian game in order to start a race. He sent us in order to finish a race. Heaven is on tippy toes watching us. God is up from his throne and watching us as we are wobbling through life, and sometimes it's so difficult to keep on running. Yet heaven did not send us here in order to start a race. Heaven did not send us here to play church or to play Christianity. Heaven sent us here to be a testimony and to run the race till we finish it. We are sent here to leave a testimony and to give a legacy to our children. Are you running? Or you've given long, long, long ago? Oh. Because heaven did not send us here and did not send you here to start a race. We are here to finish it. So today, on behalf of God, I would like to ask you, finish the race. Don't give up. No matter where you are right now in your race, no matter how much it hurts, no matter how much inconvenient it is, no matter how contra American dream it may sound, God is with you. God enabled you to start this game. God will enable you to finish it. Don't give up. Finish the race. Would you please help me out and take out of your bulletin the yellow connection card? Let's make a few practical decisions that actually are going to enable us to finish the race, not just listen to the race and not just be spectators of a preacher who talked about the race. Let's finish it. And let's make today decisions that will reverberate through eternity. So please take your connection card, and I hope by that time you've already put your name on the front. Turn it to the back. And I have three action steps to suggest. Check the one that applies to you the most. Check the one that you really are determined to start doing. First, dear Lord, give me that fearless faith which will transform my life and the life of the people around me. If you are praying this prayer, if you listen to this sermon and you said, God, I'm a coward, but I don't want to be, check this one. Second, I will make my life on this earth count by living according to what counts in God's book. If you really want to comply to the word of God, you really want to become his minister and his living testimony, check this one. And finally, make me a walking sermon. Let my deeds and attitudes preach a compelling message wherever I go. May God bless us all in our decision making, and may we become a living testimony to children and grandchildren, to colleagues and friends, and even enemies. May God bless you all.
Hymn number 321, My Jesus, I Love Thee. We'll sing all four verses.
Jesus, I love Thee. I call Thou art mine. For Thee are the valleys of sin, my needs are.
For the benediction, I would like to remind you this evening, 6 o'clock, is the concert. Invite your friends. If you don't have any, invite your enemies. They'll enjoy it. So let's bow our heads for prayer. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by such great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so often easily entails us, and let us run with endurance, with confidence, the race that is set before us, looking into Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And Father, today as we contemplate this message through the words of Apostle Paul, we would like to ask you to give us courage. We would like to ask you, Lord, to make us a living testimony by obeying your every word. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we ask, and all the people of God said together, Amen.